Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Ye, currently Associate Professor of Neurology in Taipei Medical University. Also joint appointment Associate Professor in International Master PhD Program in Medicine. Today, my topic is genetics in Parkinson's disease, from clinic to bench. This is today's outline. We start from the clinical aspect, then introduce genetic discovery and describe some of my genetic research and the future perspective. Parkinson's disease is known as Dr. James Parkinson. He published an essay on the shaking palsy in 1817. He described 6 patients in London presenting with involuntary tremor with lessened muscle power, in parts not in action, and even when supported with a propensity to bend the trunk forward and to pass from a walking to a running pace, but the sense and the intellect are unaffected. Later, French neurologist and pathologist Dr. Jean-Martin Charcot used his names to describe this disease as Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is the second most common neurodegenerative disease in the elderly population. The prevalence is age-dependent, 0.5 to 1% of the population aged 65 years, increasing to 1 to 3% of the population over 80s. The lifetime risk of developing Parkinson's disease is about 1.5%. As the aging population, the same as Alzheimer's disease, there is increased number of neurodegenerative diseases in aging population. The gender difference in Parkinson's disease is slightly more often in men than women. The prevalence of some neurodegenerative diseases is similar in United States and Taiwan. For example, the Alzheimer's disease and the amyotrophic lateral sclerosis and the spinal cerebellar ataxia, those are the same prevalence in US and Taiwan. But for Parkinson's disease, it's a little less than US and much less in multiple sclerosis, spinal cerebellar, and Huntington disease. The clinical motor symptom is the major presentation of Parkinson's disease, TRAP, TRAP. Coincide with resting tremor, like the pill rolling or counting pill, and the cochlear rigidity and the bradykinesia. As the in face, we can see the mask face or slow of the motion, and the postural instability. Sometimes we can see the stupid posture to bend forward and the fascinating gait, and sometimes resulting in falls. This is a lady showed a resting tremor over the hand and the legs. Also the slow movement of her hand. This is a gentleman show asymmetry of slow movement, slower movement over his left arm and the left leg. And when he walks, there's a reduced arm swing in his left side. The pathological hallmark of Parkinson's disease include neuronal loss and the Lewy body. There's a loss of a neural melanin containing neuron in the substantia nigra pars compacta. About 50 to 60% of the dopamine neuron are lost before the motor symptom of Parkinson's disease appear. The Lewy body is an eosinophilic inclusion, which is alpha-synuclein immunopositive. The basal ganglia control the movement. The basal ganglia motor circuit was shown in normal Parkinsonian state and the levodopa-induced dyskinesia in this figure. When we plan a movement, the motor cortex innervate the striatum to activate the D1 receptor and inhibit the D2 receptor. The D1 receptor forms the direct pathway, then through the GPI SNR, then to the thalamus, then back to the motor cortex to control the movement. The indirect pathway is from striatum through the D2 receptor to GPE, to subthalamic nucleus, and to GPI SNR, and then to the thalamus, and then back to the motor cortex. The substantia nigra pars compacta control the D1 and D2 activity. So in Parkinsonian state, there's a loss of substantia nigra dopaminergic neuron result in the hypoactivity of the direct pathway to inhibit the GPI SNR, but increase the inhibition to the thalamus, finally result in the activation of motor cortex or reduce, so became the bradykinesia. The clinical diagnostic criteria for Parkinson's disease has been revised by International Parkinson's Disease and Movement Disorder Society in 2015. The Parkinsonian, mainly bradykinesia in combination with at least one of the resting tremor or rigidity are the core feature. The diagnosis of clinical established PD requires absent or absolute exclusion criteria and at least two supportive criteria and no red flag signs. The clinical probable Parkinson's disease requires absent of absolute exclusion criteria and the presence of red flags counterbalanced by supportive criteria. The supportive criteria include clear and dramatic beneficial response to dopaminergic therapy, presence of levodopa-induced dyskinesia, resting tremor, and the presence of either olfactory loss or cardiac sympathetic denervation on NIBG scintigraphy. The clinical diagnosis of Parkinson's disease is important because it's useful for patient counseling and the therapeutic planning and essential for clinical research. However, age at onset is very variable and the disease can present with wide range of motor and non-motor symptoms. The initial diagnosis accuracy rate is about 60% and the final clinical diagnosis accuracy rate is around 77%. Besides a typical PD, there are several atypical Parkinsonism. For typical PD, there's several features you should notice, including the unilateral onset, slow and progressive movement disorder, good response to dopaminergic medications, and no atypical features. The atypical Parkinsonisms include Parkinson plus syndrome, like the multiple system atrophy, progressive supranuclear palsy, cortical basal degeneration, and dementia of Lewy body type. And for the others and the secondary Parkinsonian, such as brain tumor, stroke, head injury, tossing, encephalitis, hydrocephalus, can cause the same Parkinsonian feature. And also the hereditary degenerative disease like spinal cerebellar ataxia, Wilson's disease, Huntington disease, those can present like Parkinson's disease. So the clinical diagnostic criteria, there's an absolutely exclusion criteria coincide the typical feature. For example, the cerebellar abnormality is multiple system atrophy type C. For the downward vertical gaze palsy is progressive supranuclear palsy, and the early onset dementia perpetual behavior variant of frontotemporal dementia, those are probably the diffuse Lewy body disease. And the affected lower limb is vascular Parkinsonism, and sometimes is a drug-induced Parkinsonian, or there's a cortical sensory loss in cortical basal syndrome, and sometimes there's a functional or psychogenic movement disorder. The red flag signs, for example, the rapid progression of gait impairment or absence of progression of motor symptom, or severe autonomic failure, those are the red flag signs. The neural image of Parkinson's disease usually used as to describe the dopamine neuron loss and the dopamine deficit. We can use the dopamine transporter image, TC99 Chode image. This drug can bind it to the dopamine transporter at the dopaminergic synapse. It can present the feature like the dopamine presynaptic dopamine deficit. 3T NRI can exclude some secondary cause of the Parkinsonism. And also in the SWI image, we can see the nigrosome 1 image. There's when Parkinson's disease patient, there's loss of the nigrosome 1. So the swallowtail became blurred and cannot see. The other is the transcranial ultrasound. We can see in Parkinson's disease patient, there's a substantial nigra, there's increased echogenicity. Neural image also you use for differentiate a typical Parkinsonian. For example, the multiple system atrophy, the image you can see from the A is putamen atrophy, and the hard cross bone sign on the pons and the cerebellar atrophy. Those are the features of the multiple system atrophy. For progressive supranuclear palsy, we can see the atrophy of the tecton of the midbrain. So there's a like penguin sign or hummingbird sign on the sagittal NRI, and the in morning glory sign as in axial view of NRI. And for cortical basal syndrome, it's usually an asymmetry onset cause, presenting with the cortical sensory loss, asymmetry, dystonia or Parkinsonism. And as for the image, we can see the asymmetry loss, atrophy of the parietal lobe and the reduced perfusion of the parietal lobe. And for vascular Parkinsonian, we can see the extensive lesion of the periventricular white matter, and this white matter lesion cause ramping correspond to gait abnormality and reduced gait velocity. And for normal pressure hydrocephalus, there's a triad include cognitive impairment, gait disturbance, and incontinence. In image, we can see the dilated ventricular megaly. For Parkinson's disease, the Hong and the Yang scale is the most common used scale to measure the severity. It's classified from stage 1 to 5. The stage 1 is unilateral involuntary movement only. Stage 2 is bilateral. Stage 3 is mild to moderate disease, physically independent. Stage 4 and with assistance. Stage 5 is wheelchair bound.
Does he ever speak to you?
For the treatment of Parkinson's disease, there's an old movie,
patients, doctor,
Awakening, casted by Robert De Niro and Robin Williams, based on a true story.
I know it.
I just wanted to say to you,
is encephalitis lethargica pandemic in 1920 to 1930. The Dr. Sachs tried the levodopa dramatically changed the motor symptom and treated the patient. If you have time, you can take a look at this video, this movie. It's very, very good. So for levodopa therapy in Parkinson's disease, there are two Nobel Prize. One is R.V. Carson. He found that dopamine is the main problem of Parkinson's disease, and the supply of dopamine can rescue the Parkinsonian phenotype. The other is William North. He is a chemist. He found a chemical method to convert to allophone chemical more efficiently. Because the elephant is bioactive. The pioneer of levodopa therapy start from R.B. Carson and the clinician Holmes Kiwis and Cotius. R.B. Carson first in his study, he used the dopamine depleter reserpine to induce the Parkinsonian. After supplied the dopamine, the rabbit became normal. Nowadays, we use the treatment for Parkinson's disease, mainly the dopaminergic therapy, include the supply of the dopamine because the dopamine cannot cross the BBB. So we use the levodopa to enter the neuron and convert to the dopamine in the dopaminergic neurons. And we also can use the dopamine agonist to activate the dopaminergic receptor. And there's COMT inhibitor and NLRP inhibitor can decrease the metabolism of levodopa dopamine in the synapse. Other medications, for example, the anticholinergic or amantadine, are supportive. Also, in some patients, they in advanced stage they present with motor complication, for example, the wearing of an unwell phenomenon and the levodopa induced dyskinesia. Some patients might have benefit for deep brain stimulation therapy. The deep brain stimulation therapy for Parkinson's disease, we can insert implant an electrode by Stereotech method and via the intraoperative microelectrode recording to reach the correct site. This is an example. As the neuron death and the disease progression, the therapeutic window gets narrowing. Means there's a shorter drug effect and a fluctuation drug level. This results in motor complication, including wearing off, on-off phenomenon, and dyskinesia. So, for Parkinson's disease, it's still a progressive neurodegenerative disorders. According to the Barak staging published in 2003, there's a pathology change from medulla to cortex. And the clinical symptom and the of Parkinson's disease progress over the time. And there's some non-motor symptom even appear 5 to 10 years before the motor symptom. For example, the constipation or REM sleep behavior disorder or hypoxemia or olfactory dysfunction, those can appear before the motor symptom. And as the disease progression, 8 to 10 years later, there's a motor complication appear. So, and some patient also may have dementia, cognitive decline. Who will get the Parkinson's disease? There are some celebrity in the history, like Adolf Hitler, Pope John Paul, and Boxer Ali. So anyone may has chance, but there's a story about the MPTP. This is because in 1980, there's a gentleman, Dr. William Langston, found several patients presenting with Parkinsonian feature. They use the impure fentanyl analog, MPP. This MPTP can convert to MPP. MPP can cause the complex 1 inhibition and destroy the dopaminergic neurons. So that toxin can cause the neurodegeneration of dopaminergic neurons. Currently, about the pathogenesis of Parkinson's disease include aging, genetic factors, environmental factors, lifestyle factor. Those factors result in several molecular pathways, including alpha-synuclein misfold and aggregation, impaired protein clearance, and the mitochondrial dysfunction, and the neural inflammation. About hereditary of Parkinson's disease, in early study in 1880s, Gao described 15% of his patients has a positive family history of PD. But in twin study, there's about 10 to 20%. And approximately 10 to 15% of people with PD have a family history of this disorder. The genetic discoveries start from the familial study for start from 1997. The first discover is alpha-synuclein mutation. The next year is Parkin mutation, Park 2. This is a familial PD Park gene loci. Park 1 is alpha-synuclein. Park 2 is Parkin gene. Is a E3 ubiquitin protein ligase presenting with early onset Parkinsonian slow progression and some feature of dystonia. And the other is several Park gene has been identified in the following 20 years. The genetic variant is not only the familial gene. There's still several genetic variant can increase the risk of Parkinson's disease. The Park 1 is discovered by Dr. Polymeropoulos. He found it in several families in the alpha-synuclein gene mutation. This is the first PD gene published. The next year, Professor Mizuno, he described several patients with autosomal recessive Juvenile onset Parkinsonian. Finally, they found the genes Parkin. Parkin is a E3 ubiquitin ligase. Functions as the protein aggregation adherence. The clinical summary of previous study showed that a patient with Parkinson gene mutation, most of them, the age onset is around 28, and there's about one third patient has dystonia, and the genetic finding of 33 patients with Parkinson genes mutations, several of them are exon deletion. The PARCIS is published, is found in 2004 by Dr. Valente. Our PARC6 patient with PINK1 mutation carrier, they present with early onset Parkinsonian from 17 to 37 years, and those of them have the levodopa-induced dyskinesia, and the image can see the reduced presynaptic dopaminergic deficit. And the PARC8 is an autosomal dominant found by Pearson-Ruiz and the Zimprich 2 group. The most attracting mutation is LRRK2 G2019S because it is in high frequency in Northern American, Arab, and Ashkenazi Jews, even in sporadic cases, but it's not appear in our population in Taiwan or Hong Kong or Japan. In Taiwan, LRRK2 G2385R is ethnic specific genetic risk factor, not G2019S. The LRRK2 G2385R modulate the age at onset in PD. Younger age at onset for carrier versus wild type. For the LRRK2 mutation, its proof of concept is a common genetic determinant in typical late onset PD, even in autosomal dominant family or sporadic cases. And for G2385R and R1628P are genetic risk factor in Asian populations. The PARC14 is PAR2G6 mutation identified by Pearson-Lewis. But PAR2G6 also can cause a neurodegenerative disorder with high brain iron. Our PAR2G6 mutation carrier linked young onset Parkinson disease, we found there's a three family present the early onset Parkinsonian. Also, we found there's a increased risk of Parkinson disease when carry the PAR2G6 genetic variant. The Park 17 is in VPS 35 gene mutation. And the GBA also this causing gene of Gaucher disease has found increased risk of Parkinson's disease around fivefold. From 2005, the genetic GWAS study became more and more popular. So there's several susceptibility genes or locus for PD have been identified. The first GWAS in PD was done by Maragano in 2005. And the genetic risk factor for Parkinson's disease, we can see for alpha-synuclein, LRRK2, NAPT, those also appear in the familial Parkinson's disease. So from the GWAS study, the sporadic cases also carry the similar Parkin gene as the familial cases. This is a website we can take a look at the GWAS study of genetic in Parkinson's disease. Also, we can see the common genomic insight of Parkinson's disease. So, in the genetic part, we can see some rare cases have the familial case, especially familial case, those have the Park gene. And some sporadic, substantial sporadic cases carry the common genetic variant. So, genetic factor may be an important contribution for the Parkinson's disease, but they still have another factors may influence the disease onset. So, nowadays, we think the Parkinson's disease, the development of Parkinson's disease is interaction between the environmental risk factors and the genetic risk factors. So let's talk about my research. My previous research in a Taiwanese cohort, we found that in young onset Parkinson's disease, age at onset less than 30 years, we can find about one-third of patients are Parkin gene mutation, followed by PINK1, then PAR2G6 mutation. For sporadic cases, about 17% patients are LRRK2 G23 85R or R1628P genetic variant, and about 3.7% are GBA genetic variant. We also have do the G20 investigated the G2019S LRRK2. We found that G2019S LRRK2 mutation can augment kinase activity of phosphorylating MAP kinase 4 at the serine 257 residue to cause the disease. So it's the gain of function mutation. For PARC14, PAR2G-linked Parkinsonian, this patient we can see this is our patient. He's 25 years old. Has dystonia and the Parkinsonian feature, slow of movement. PAR2G6 mutation in PARC14 linked young-onset Parkinsonian. In Taiwan, we found that there's a D331Y is a more prevalent PAR2G6 genetic variant. It's also been found in some sporadic cases. Interestingly, in this study, we found another mutation, the genetic mutation C 11077G to A. If we read the genomic feature, it's just in the boundary of the splicing site. But this mutation can cause aberrant splicing according to the cDNA sequencing. Our clinical feature of our PAR2G6 mutation carrier, those are early onset, less than 30 years, and have levodopa-induced dyskinesia, and some of them have ataxia, and almost all three have psychosis and demented. And if in sporadic cases, there's increased risk of PD in 3.68-fold. PAR2G6 is a calcium-independent phospholipase, highly expressed in the brain. And it hydrolyzes the SN2 ester bond in phospholipids. PAR2G6 also can have different phenotype, including the neurodegeneration with brain iron accumulation, NBIA, infantile neuroaxonal dystrophy, NAD, and Parkinson disease 14, PARC14. PAR2G6 is an important function in membrane lipid structure and function. It can be found in cell membrane, lysosome membrane, and mitochondria. In our study on the PARC14 PAR2G6 mutation, we found that the PARC14 mutant PAR2G6 inhibit an impaired enzyme activity of phospholipase A2. And when expression the wild type PAR2G6, but not PARC14 mutant PAR2G6, can attenuate rotenone-induced cell death of SH-SY5Y dopaminergic cells. Also, the PARC14 mutant PAR2G6 is ineffective preventing the rotenone-induced mitochondrial dysfunction, and also in the mitochondria study, we can see the complex one activity decrease, ATP generation decrease, and the increased cytochrome C release. Further, we do the knocking mouse study using the PARC14 D331Y PAR2G6. You can see the in wild type, you can the movement disorders in D331Y homozygous mouse. And the PAR2G6 D331Y homozygous knocking mouse displayed loss of the dopaminergic cells in substantia nigra pars compacta, and also the Lewy body can be seen in the homozygous PAR2G6 D331Y knocking mouse at the age of 6 months, 9 months, sorry. And those are alpha-synuclein pars immunoreactive. And the immunoblotting analysis showed an upregulated protein expression of alpha-synuclein, phospho-alpha-synuclein, phospho-tau in the substantia nigra of homozygous PAR2G6 D331Y knocking mouse. Also, the mitochondrial structure can be disrupted in the homozygous PAR2G6 D331Y knocking mouse. And the mitochondrial function study, we can see the homozygous D331Y PAR2G6 knocking mouse show a decrease of activity of the mitochondria complex 1 and 3, decrease intracellular ATP generation, and the increased overproduction of reactive oxygen species, increased level of mitochondrial lipid per oxidation, and the increased cytosolic level of cytochrome C. Also, the homozygous D331Y PAR2G6 mutation can cause an activation of mitochondrial apoptosis cascade induced ER stress and the mitophage dysfunction. In a zebrafish study, we also found D331Y can cause abnormal local motor behavior of zebrafish, and the number of dopaminergic neurons reduced in D331 injection. So, in this part, we want to see the possible rescue mechanism in PAR2G6 mutation zebrafish. We use the DHA to rescue to see the rescue effect. In this study, we also take a look at the dietary DHA supplement in PAR2G6 homozygous D331Y knocking mouse. As the zebrafish study, dietary DHA supplement also improve the motor deficit in D331Y homozygous knocking mouse. So the risk factor for Parkinson's disease from epidemiology studies include the some factor may reduce risk factor, for example, the exercise, caffeine, and smoking, and the some Some may increase risk, such as genetic contribution, toxin like MPTP or retinol, and head injury, infection, and inflammation. Environmental factor of developing PD has been studied in a Taiwanese cohort published in 1997. They found that there's an increased risk of PD when people living in rural residence, growing rice, doing farmer work, use of the herbicide, pesticide, and the paraquat use. Actually, the pesticide application, paraquat, rotenone, or organochloroquine, those are frequently used pesticide or herbicide in the past, greatly increase the risk of Parkinson's disease. So rotenone is previous use as a pesticide. Rotenone can inhibit the complex one and reduce the NAD formation. NAD is a cofactor of aldehyde dehydrogenase. And aldehyde dehydrogenase is an important enzyme to convert toxic DOPA to non-toxic DOPA. In Taiwan and the South Asia population, there's a high frequency of E487K mutation, is ALDH2 STAR2 variant. Those who carry the homozygous E487K mutation have reduced the ALDH2 activity to 3%. For heterozygous, it's reduced to 20 to 40% of activity. In Taiwan, there's a 45% of patients carry this genetic variant. In China, 40%, Korean 20%, and Japan 30%. So we hypothesize that aldehydrogenase is important to relate it to the dopamine neuron loss and increase the risk for PD because there's some environmental factors and toxin may inhibit ALDH activity and the ALDH enzyme polymorphism also can cause the reduced activity of ALDH enzyme. So the genetic and the environmental factor they combine in combination cause the ALDH dysfunction and increase the toxic aldehyde. Healthy aldehyde those are come from the ischemic perfusion injury, increased ROS or monoamine metabolism, lipid oxidation. Increased toxic aldehyde can cause protein aggregation or directly induce the neuronal dysfunction or death. In our study, we found that wild-type ALDH2 but not mutant ALDH2 STAR2 protects against rotenone-induced cell death. We also apply the ADAR1, which is a LDH2 activator, increase the LDH activity. Administration of ADA1 prevents rotenone-induced mitochondrial dysfunction. And the ADA1 also ameliorates rotenone-induced dopamine neuronal death in substantia nigra in the mice. So for the genetic in clinical medicine, the genetic discovery, we can do the genetic counseling, and decoding the genetic, we can identify the risk of developing disease. And also the genetic discovery can help to study the disease mechanism or create an animal model. And the important is genetic directed therapy is precision medicine era. Those are the current genetics contribution in clinical medicine. Like the cartoons say, DNA is a fortune telling in part. Google billionaire's Sergey Brin, he revealed his high risk of Parkinson's disease in 2008 in his blog. The story is because Brin's mother and aunt suffered from Parkinson's disease. He did the genetic testing. He found he was carrying a LRRK2 G2019S mutation. After he ran a test provided by 23andMe, while the exact implication of test results are not clear, Brin said it meant his chance of developing a disease compared with the average population is about 20 to 80% depending on the study and how you measure. So Serge Brin said, this leaves me in a rather unique position. I know early in my life something I am substantially predisposed to. I now have the opportunity to adjust my life to reduce those odds. It's optimistic thought. The genetic contribution in the research, also we can see in familial cases, the pathology finding in familial PD and the sporadic PD are similar. Those are neuronal loss and the Lewy body formation. And the study tells us those PARC genes identified in the familial cases are important in the pathogenesis of Parkinson's disease, for example, in the Purkinje aggregation or mitochondrial dysfunction or lysosome storage problem or mitophage or autophage problem. So the future of the development of potential treatment target is based on the finding of the genetic study and the environmental factors. There are several medications developing underway. For example, the LRRK2, we know LRRK2 is a gain of function mutation in autosomal dominant LRRK2 G2019S. So the LRRK2 inhibitor like the LT I-291 or Embosso or venglustate. Those are the LRRK2 inhibitor. So in Chinese proverb, there's by the Huangdi Neijing in 2600 BC, it said superior doctors prevent the disease. Mediocre doctors treat the disease before event. Inferior doctors treat the full-blown disease. So it's the sort of the preventive medicine and personalized medicine. Hopefully, the genetic and the environmental factor influence the aging speed. So hopefully we can do the early prevention or slowly progression. Thank you very much. If you have any question, you can email me.